Good afternoon, everybody. How is everyone feeling? Good? Really? Are you sleepy after all that pasta and risotto? No? Ready for some more excitement this afternoon? So did all of you see the tech fair? Yeah? I managed to go in very quickly, and the minute I walked in, I got stalked by that robot. It kept chasing me till it took a photo, and then it was the worst photo because I think I looked quite scared. how many of you had a good experience with the big robot, the one that was rolling around? Yeah, what did you think of it? Yeah, well, that's good because, you know, the future of work is about human-robot interaction, and then I went and played with the ABB coffee robot. And I think the team there was explaining to me that they built that robot to teach, you know, some of the team to engage better. And how better than when you need that afternoon shot of single espresso, which was fantastic. What was great is I saw that robot then switch off the machine because it knew that it wasn't to waste power. So that was quite amazing. And then I saw the VR experience. Did any of you have a chance to put on those glasses? Yeah? And that I thought was really interesting. It's a great way to test skill sets. So this was done for the Met Police in London, and it was to help them test out real-world scenarios to test how they can actually work as a teammate in the police force in London, which in itself is quite scary. Right. So this afternoon session, I just wanted to, again, remind you of why we're here. We're here to co-create, collaborate, concrete words and vision, and to act on it. So earlier on today, I had also in this morning sessions, I had a chance to go in and see some of the sessions in action. It was very cool up there, just a beautiful place to really think of things. And one of the observations I had, a lot of time was spent framing the question and what we're trying to do over the next now day and a half. And really what I'd encourage you to do in the breakout sessions this afternoon is start thinking of solutions. Because by the end of tomorrow, we really want to have these solutions that you as leaders in your organizations come up with. So really, really encourage you. We know the problem. All of us are here because we know that's the problem. So let's start driving towards solutions. So the first session, one of the things I love that Alain said this morning is he talked about the multi-stakeholder environment that we're working in. And I think the next two sessions are really talking about that. So the first session, we have sort of between government policy and also corporate, so Adecco Group. So we have Alain Dehaze, the CEO of the Adecco Group, and Guy Ryder, who's the Director General of the International Labour Organization. And they're going to be talking about a white paper that has been created and some of the observations that they've had as a part of a dialogue and a task force that they've worked on. So with that, Alain and Guy, over to you.
Thank you very much. And also, welcome back to all of you. Indeed, we are starting this afternoon with a conversation with one of the stakeholders we are not so used to, especially when you are in the business. And this stakeholder is the International Labour Organization. And Guy Ryder is the General Director of the International Labour Organization. So perhaps to start with, and also for the people here in the room to understand, what is the ILO? And what is the Director General doing at the ILO?
Good question. Well, Anne, firstly, thank you for having us here. The International Labour Organization is 100 years old, a 100-year-old organization. We're part of the United Nations, a specialized agency of the United Nations, with a peculiarity that we're actually 25 years older than the UN. We were there before then.
Okay.
We were set up after the First World War and indeed the Russian Revolution because people started to say to each other, you know, we better have a look at the future of work. We better have a look at the type of future of work we want to create. Otherwise, things can happen. Otherwise, things can happen. And so our organization, which has a very unique feature, it brings together not just governments, but also the employer community, employer representatives, and worker representatives, tripartite, with a mission to advance, and this is an important phrase in our organization, to advance social justice. The creation of the ILO can be seen perhaps as the greatest social contract in history. This contracting of governments, and today we have 187 governments, coming together with both sides of industry to say, we're coming here, we're contracting together to combine our efforts to create the future of work that we want, one which is fair, one which is just. And 100 years ago, that's a pretty good message for today, I would say, Alain.
Absolutely. That is a very good segue to what you have kicked off in October 2017. You have created a global commission, which was, let's say, responsible to look at the future of work. But why? Why did you take this decision, the goal, and so on, almost 100 years later?
Look, again, as we approach this 100th birthday, we thought this is not a time to have a big birthday party. This is a time to look forward, try to understand what's happening in the world of work. I think everybody would agree that today the world of work is changing more quickly, more profoundly, more fundamentally than we've ever seen before, not just in our lifetimes, but in previous lifetimes. And so we thought, for the purposes of our own organization, but more than that, for the reinvigorating this social contract, that it was time to look at these changes and try to plot out exactly what I think you're here to do today.
Yeah.
Some of the answers to these challenges and the new world of work which is coming into being. And there's one thought behind all of this, Alain, which I think is terribly important listening to the debates this morning. You know, it's a mistake, is it not, to think that the future of work is out there waiting for us. It's already decided, or it will be decided autonomously by technology or other things. The future of work will be decided by people like you. It will be decided by policymakers, by business, and it should be decided upon very much in function of what we want the future to be. So this is a policy debate.
Yeah.
It's a debate about what we want for our future at work and in society.
We will come back to that later on. So October 2017, the Global Commission, and then 1 month ago, 20th of January, you came to the big public together with the two chairmen, Cyril Ramaphosa, the president of South Africa, and Stefan Löfven, the prime minister of Sweden. You came with the output. So can you describe the output and the recommendation of this Global Commission?
Yeah, if you can look out our report, I think it will repay your reading. We think we've produced a good report on the future of work. Not unexpectedly, we had a good commission. Alain, you were a member of it, so it was a guarantee
no
of
publicity.
So this is a report which is short, readable, accessible, and action-oriented. And what it does is set out what we describe, and consciously so, as a human-centered agenda for the future of work. We think it fundamentally important, for the reasons I've already mentioned, that we start to put together a future of work which actually meets what people want and what they need to the future. And what does that sort of unpack as? It unpacks as a series of investments in three areas. The first area of investment is in the human being and in their capacities. And above all, and we've already been talking about this, it means that there needs to be, we believe in the future, an entitlement to lifelong learning.
So really
an entitlement, a right.
A right, an investment in people and their capabilities. This
Absolutely.
Is linked to this lifelong learning.
Yeah, and everybody talks about this. I've never really met anybody who disagrees with the concept of lifelong learning. It's not the what, it's the how are we going to do this. And I think our efforts now need to be directed to constructing the delivery systems for lifelong learning. And that begs the question of financing, of course, thereafter.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then we have to move very quickly to implementing, because you know the day when we could, like I did, get educated for 20 years and then work for the next 50, it's gone.
It's over.
We have to do the two things throughout working lives. Yeah. So this is one element of the investing in people. It also comes with a new focus on social protection systems. You know, if you want people to adapt and to embrace change, give them the feeling of security that they're safe to do so. And so we need to invest in social protection, which may look a bit different from what it has done in the past. And I don't want to leave out either, I put it in brackets, but it's vital, the whole gender question. We need a transformative agenda for gender equality in the future. So
good.
That's the first area.
So the first area, more investment in people and their capabilities. Second investment area is more in the institutions of work.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate on this, what it means, especially for this community?
Yeah, let's start from something which is in the ILO's constitution right from the beginning. We put it to people that labor's not a commodity. Labor is not just something to be traded on labor markets. And that's why over many, many years, we've developed the institutions of labor markets. Rules, regulations, bargaining, procedures, all of those things that make your life quite difficult probably at certain points.
Sometimes.
Now, the reality is that as work changes, and it's the nature of work that is changing as much as the quantity of work, these institutions begin to look a little bit perhaps inadequate to cope with the realities of the future. If I say one word to explain what I mean, it would be uberization. I know we have so many debates about who's an employer, who's an employee, but just that's the tip of an iceberg. We today have institutions, regulations, which don't easily fit the emerging realities. So we need to invest in these institutions. And I'll just mention two of the areas that we focus upon. One is the notion that we need a universal labor guarantee. We see the diversification of work forms. What we used to call, and some of us still do call, the standard employment contract or arrangement. It's just one out of many forms of jobs now. And we need to say that whatever place you have in this diversified labor market, you need a level playing field. You should not be disadvantaged by working in whatever place it might be. And the second bit, and it comes from that, is a whole question of the platform economy, the gig economy. Now, some people think this is just a niche. Other people think what we have today is the precursor of a generalized form of work in the future. Our commission takes the view that we need to look seriously now at the international organization and regulation of this emerging platform economy.
Thank you, Guy. And then the third pillar of the conclusion is about, more investment in decent and sustainable jobs. In the context we know, in this changing world, in this accelerating technology inroad, can you also elaborate on this?
Alain, I think you remember from the Commission, we had to deal with this issue of, are we heading towards a future of chronic work scarcity? You know, we've already been through the end of work scenario a few years back.
Yeah.
Hasn't happened yet. But there is a lot of feeling out there that there is going to be a scarcity of jobs in the future. And that led us to say, look, there are out there in this Schumpeterian creative destruction scenario, there are obvious areas where jobs are going to be created, and we need to invest in those areas. And just to give the headlines, the green economy, you know, carbon neutrality, it's not going to be an option, it's going to be an obligation in the future. That imposes enormous challenges for productive systems, but it offers enormous opportunities for the future as well. So green jobs. Second, the care economy. Aging societies, youthful societies, depends what part of the world you look at, but we really do need to take a look at the way that care is delivered in our societies. Today, much of it, unpaid, informal, women taking the burden. We see the need for a professionalization and upgrading of the care economy. Third area is in, it's very obvious, infrastructure. The creation of digital and physical infrastructure where the needs are crying. And finally, and I don't want to apologize before this audience of saying it, can we all remember that 60% of the world's workers work in informality, very often in the rural economy? We can't forget about that part of
Absolutely.
The world. When you've got 187 member states, Alain, you need to look wide. So those are the areas.
Good. And so listening at agenda or human-centric agenda, the three pillars of more investment, and all of this included in a new social contract, in a reinvigorated social contract, what should we say about this?
Well, we argued a lot about the wording, didn't we? But I was interested this morning to hear Brad Smith say we need a renewed or a reinvigorated social contract. And I think this is something that's really worth thinking about. Mm. Opinions may differ depending where you come from, how you look at these things, but there is, I think, a very broad feeling out there, and we feel it in our politics as well as in our working lives, that social contract which exists in our societies, which defines what people can reasonably expect of their governments, of their employers, of their working life, somehow that expectation is under pressure, under strain, or has been broken. And that's what we're seeing. There's a high degree of anger out there, high degree of frustration, and a high degree of uncertainty verging on fear about the future. We think, and our commission takes this up, is one good way of addressing this type of attitude is to commit ourselves. And when I say ourselves, I mean governments, because we're in a public policy debate here. Governments, business, and the labour side of the story, we need to come together, work out what we want for the future, and renew a commitment. And I want to recall that 100-year-old commitment to a future with stability and social justice, and then say, this is our project for the future of work, and then set about joining our forces together to bring it about. Is that fanciful? Is it slightly too utopian? My view is we cannot afford to be less realistic than this. This is what our moment requires of us.
Good. We have in front of us and together with us today also a lot of business people. Based on the social contract and that we have discussed, the report and so on, what is the advice you give to the whole community here of people attending once they are back on Friday in their companies and people are asking, hey, what did you learn in Milano?
Look, I think that the key thing here is these are a set of questions, these are a set of challenges which concern us all, including the business community. Now, you know, I'm sure there are many here who have a very clear idea of the future trajectory of their company, what you can do in terms of societal results, in terms of job creation. But, you know, when you take each of those individual company stories and success stories that I'm sure are down the road, just aggregate them and try to think what the overall consequences for our future societies are of your individual efforts. And I think if you do that, probably we would all agree that we're all into something together which is slightly bigger than just an individual company's efforts. So I think take home with you the thought that this concerns you. This is not somebody else's story or somebody else's problem, but also ours. And we need to work together and be a part of the types of solutions out there for the future.
Guy Ryder, Director General of the ILO, thank you.
Thank you both. Thank you, thank you. So with that, we're going to go out to Q&A to the audience. So if you have any questions, please raise your hands. We have people with microphones, and we'd love to really have you engage. We have a gentleman here in the front row.
Thank you for a fascinating talk there. My name's Robert Newry, Managing Director of Arctic Shores. I wondered, is the capitalist system against all the great things that you are asking for? If you look at quarterly reports, you see organizations talking about reducing employees in order to meet market needs. And how do you think we can get round what seems to be these parallel forces, capitalism requiring more profit and a social contract actually requiring a more humanistic approach?
Should I take that one immediately, if I might? Yeah, I think it's a great question. You know, I'm in a bit of a historical sort of mindset at the moment. The interesting thing, when the ILO was set up, the people that were really against the ILO were the Soviet Union and the revolutionary forces, because they saw that this was actually an agenda that would give sustainability and success to something they didn't like, the capitalist system. So, I mean, my point of view on all of this, and I think it is pretty widely shared, is that, you know, we need to provide some of the answers to the questions that I've tried to outline about the future of work. You know, it's almost, you know, saving capitalism, or it's almost directing capitalism along a future trajectory when it can deliver its promises and its benefits. I think the social contract, if we accept that thesis, has within it the idea of a social license to operate. And that applies to businesses. And I'm sure you deal with those concepts in your business models. You know, I think that the appearance of corporate social responsibility, this extraordinary boom we've seen in the last couple of decades, responds to that thought. So is this agenda inimical in any way to capitalism? I would argue the opposite, but I do think it requires an engagement in the process of thought and reflection from those who are in business and from governments as well to construct these answers, which I think are, I don't want to overstate it, but I think they're preconditions of sustainability. I don't think it's overstating the issue.
We have the gentleman in the front row. Please say who you are and who you work with and what you do so we can know all about you.
I'm Denis Penel, the managing director of the World Employment Confederation, which is the trade association representing the employment and recruitment industry at the global level. And I have actually a very personal question to Alain, because you were, it's just between the two of us, you know, because you were a member of this high-level commission from the ILO on the future of work, and as far as I know, you were the only CEO of a private company being part of this high-level assembly. And you were, you know, sitting together with politicians, you know, trade unionists, academic people. And my question is very, you know, could you tell us a bit more about the insight about the discussion? Do you feel sometimes very much on your own defending the private sector? What were the main points of, you know, I would not say conflict, but divergence between the other members of the commission? Could you tell us a bit how this report has actually been produced?
In fact, we should ask Guy or how I behave among them. But no, I think it was quite surprising for me, but okay, I was selected to participate to that, so thank you, because it was an honor, really an honor to be part of this group of 26 people who were and are still sharing two commonalities. First, they were really all experts in work and employment, in labor and so on, from different angles and from different countries. We were 26 and we had the whole world around us, starting with China, US, Latin America, Russia and so on. So everybody, all the continents and a lot of countries were around the table. So really a lot of expertise. And second, all of them were passionate. Passionate by the employment, work, the opportunities of the future of work. So for me, it was always an intensive, because we were always working 3 days and two nights, full stop, starting at 8 in the morning, finishing at 11 in the night, with all the people, so from the Thursday till the Saturday morning. It was really, for me, so inspiring to be with all these people around for 3 days. So, a wonderful experience. New for us, especially when you are new in the business, you are more inclined to look at your performance, the investors and so on. And here it was taking the vision in a totally but different way, but so important for the future of the society. So a great contribution. I would like to pick your point and come back to capitalism, and because somehow I'm the one representing the business here. I'm the one also having the privilege to meet the investors every quarter. I think it is important that we add one word to the capitalism, which is inclusive. And probably the social contract is probably a way to make this capitalism sustainable by making it inclusive in a different way. So that's one aspect of the answer I would like to give. And the other one, there is a great tool and you can promote it in your companies. It's called the integrated reporting. You know, a lot of companies are reporting just the financials matrix. But going forward, I think companies soon or later will be forced to report not only on the financials, but also on the social metrics and on the environmental metrics. And this reporting, this so-called integrated reporting, is already existing. So I take the example of the Adecco Group. We are already today reporting around the three set of metrics. So this is something you can decide Friday morning.
Wow, any last minute? Okay, very last question over there. Please tell us who you are and where you're from. And then this will be the last question.
Yeah, Helmut Ludwig, I'm CIO at Siemens.
Yeah.
We have quite a discussion running if digitalization drives polarization of the society. And in some countries, for example, in Germany, there is a discussion about an unconditional base salary. Question number one to you is, was this, from your study, was there any specific recommendation on for governments how to handle this discussion or the parties there? And Alain, question to you more is, what is then the role beyond an integrative reporting that you just mentioned of companies like, global companies like Siemens?
Shall I take the universal basic income issue, I think? It was discussed, although it didn't figure very much in the final report, from which you can draw your own conclusions. But I don't think that our commission was particularly enthusiastic about the notion of entirely unconditional universal basic income, for a number of reasons. The economics. This is an extraordinarily expensive sledgehammer to bring to the story. Secondly, there are those who feel that it's actually highly regressive in its use of public funding. But I think the most persuasive argument, at least in my mind, is to say, look, we're going to actually provide income to citizens unconditionally on this basis. It feels like giving up on work. It means that we are not able to provide and distribute wealth through active participation of citizens in work. It's saying, full employment, decent work for all, we've given up. We have to look somewhere else. And my personal opinion is, you know, a life which does not offer purposeful work, there's something missing there. I think we start from the point of view that work, we need to work, not just for our material well-being, but for our own development and self-realization. A bit philosophical, but I think it's a powerful argument.
And to finish very rapidly, you get what you measure, and when you measure, you change behavior. So what does it mean? That when you start to report or to announce that in a certain period of time, you will report both internally and externally your metrics on financials, everybody knows, but on social and environmental, everybody start to be aware, start to benchmark, and start to take action to look good. I'm sorry to say that. But with this, you are really changing the whole behavior of the company towards a better future and a better future of work. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Alain and Guy.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very interesting, the whole concept of integrated reporting. How many of you have actually thought about looking at that concept in your organization before it was brought up today? Many? Okay, great. So the next session, we're going to really look at scenarios that will happen in the next 5 to 10 years of work. If you think about a lot of the great comments that Alain and Guy made, you know, about the gig economy, about, you know, from the shop floor to different skills that are required of workers, you know, with the advent of artificial intelligence, we really have to start thinking about that. So with that, this next session, we're really going to focus on that. So I'd like to introduce Judith and Daniel, and they will come on board and talk about that. So Judith and Daniel. And I should say Judith is a senior partner and MD at BCG, and Daniel is a fellow in economics at Balliol College in Oxford. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Bindi. So, Daniel, I promise I will spare you all the really difficult questions today. Like, I do a lot of work on the gig economy. We'll come back to that later. Last week, someone told me, a British journalist, and he said, "So, Judith, what will be the impact of Brexit be on the gig economy?" Right. So, I spare you any of these.
Good.
But I'd like to come back to what you're doing for a living.
Yes.
You're an economist at Oxford, and you really look at the question of how technology will impact what we work and what we will also finally earn for it. And you wrote a book a couple of years ago that I think will intrigue all of us on the future of the professions. And I remember the last discussion we had on it, and one of my friends, a lawyer, was getting rather emotional because you were describing that Your research is on the question how the jobs of business people, accountants, physicians, lawyers will change. And he said, but Daniel, your father wrote this paper on that the jobs of lawyers will disappear 20 years ago, and here I am, and I still have a job. So I'm, of course, very curious to see and to learn from you how all our jobs will change. But probably to start a bit more fundamentally, what will work be for us?
Well, I think, and my answer to the question, what is work and what will work look like, relates to the observation that your friend made, which is that he's absolutely right in the sense that we still have lots of lawyers today. And in years to come, we will have lots of people who solve legal problems as well. You know, the work in the medium term isn't going to disappear. But if you look at the tasks and activities that people do in solving legal problems today, they look very different from what they did 20 years ago, and they'll look very different in the future as well. And this, you know, one of the unhelpful things that we do, all of us, we slip into it when we talk about the future of work, is that we tend to talk about jobs. So we talk about lawyers or doctors or teachers or accountants and architects, and actually the term jobs is very unhelpful. And it's unhelpful because it, you know, we get trapped in this way of thinking that the only way that technological change can affect the work that we do is by destroying entire jobs in an instant. That either will be lawyers or there won't be lawyers in the future. And actually, you know, the really significant change happens at the level of tasks and activities, the sorts of things that make up any particular job. So there's there was a piece of research done last year which took a large collection of occupations, and what they found was that only 5% of those occupations, and there were more than 600, I think, in the study, only 5% of them were composed of tasks that could all be automated, but 60% of them were made up of tasks, 30% of which could be automated. So, and that sort of story, that sort of nuance gets lost when we think about jobs at too high a level, when we think about work at too high a level, when we think in terms of jobs, rather than try and investigate the different tasks and activities that make it up. So you are a BCG fellow on the future of work, and we've spoken various times about the research that you've done, but your research is broader than the sorts of things that I spend lots of time thinking about, which is just white-collar workers and professionals. It's more general. What does your research tell us about the future of work for the average Joe, for the rest of the workforce?
So why did we start looking at the average Joe, probably, right? We started 2 years ago, and the reason for it was that I was having this discussion with the head of strategy of one of Germany's largest banks. And he was saying, Judith, you're just not getting this. I sit on tens of thousands of call center workers, and I will not need any of them in the future. And these people are completely unwilling and unable to change. And what does that do to my competitive advantage? And in a way, I felt there was a very common theme replicated, which was the one of the dispirited worker, one where usually technology is displayed as a threat, something people really are very anxious about. So very hillbilly elegy in a way. And what disturbed us really was that we said, the media loves writing a lot about, you know, the average Joe, the majority of the workforce, but actually these are often people we write about but we don't talk to. And so we went out and we tried to collect data from 11,000 workers globally. So not only blue-collar workers, but a group of people we had designed to say the majority of people we talk to, we survey, we do research on, needs to be below their national averages when it comes both to educational attainment and to household income. So probably none of you would feature in our research. There were no master's degrees, no four-year bachelor's degrees, no prestigious colleges, but really people who were confident that they represent from China to India to Brazil to Germany, the majority of the workforce. And for me, one of the most rewarding and surprising findings was the ability of the people we asked to look at the future of work in a very holistic sense and to say, this is not only about technology for us. So we put 17 forces describing the future or a potential future of work in front of them. Everything from will your job or will your job be fundamentally changed? Will it be replaced by automation? How will people want to work? Which roles will governments play? So a very broad range. Mm. And what came back was an enormous sense of optimism that actually I hadn't expected. So workers were looking in their great majority with confidence towards the future. And when we asked them, will this future hold more opportunities or more threats to you? People very much were on the side of the opportunity, including all the technology trends. And so in a way you saw people who said, I'm overall happy with my job situation. I believe those trends will hold quite some opportunity for me in the future. And then the big question was, but can you do anything about it? You said it before, the future will not just happen to us. Is that something we can shape? And what we heard from these workers who are not business leaders were actually that over 60% said, I think one can and one should prepare for this future, and I believe I can do it. Mm-hmm. And then the next question is very evidently, but who should do it, right? Who's responsible? And 45% of workers picked as their first choice, it needs to be me. I'm primarily responsible to get this done. Versus in the choices we offered, 19% who said, it's my employer who's responsible primarily to do this, and 19% who said, it's the government. And there was surprising consistency in this data globally. There were two exceptions. One, Japan, where it was a tie between people saying, it's me and it's my employer. But frankly, look, I mean, there was also a very strong sense of own responsibility. And France, where people said, it's the government. So I'm sorry for that. So if that's true, right,
yeah.
If you have real goodwill in people, if people are willing to embrace this future, to get prepared, I think then the big question is, that is an enormous asset for you as a business leader, as an employer, and what do you do with this, right? And what potential does that offer to you? And I think in that way, you know, I'd like to come back to what's probably on all of our minds. We dealt very much with very broad segments of the workforce. You deal with, you know, the very highly skilled end of the spectrum of the workforce.
Yeah.
But how will work look like for these professions?
Yeah, so we were looking at, we looked at sort of 8 or 9 professions, lawyers, doctors, accountants, teachers, consultants, architects, even the clergy actually was one of the professions that we looked at. And very broadly what we saw were two futures for the professions. And the first one, the sense I get is that it's a sort of reassuring proposition. And it's just a more efficient version of what we have today. And here, professionals of all different types use technology, but essentially just to make their lives easier, to sort of streamline and optimize the traditional ways in which they've worked. And as you look across all the different professions, there's lots of examples of this. It's doctors talking to patients via Skype. It's architects using computer-assisted design software to design bigger, more complicated buildings. It's teachers using online material in the classrooms. But there's then a second future, and this, I think, is a more troubling proposition. And here, technology doesn't just streamline and optimize the ways in which traditional professionals have worked, but it actively displaces professionals from that work. And what we call, in our writing, increasingly capable systems and machines, either operating alone, or, and really this is quite important, just designed and operated by people that don't look a lot like traditional professionals, they gradually take on more and more of the tasks and activities that we associate with traditional lawyers and doctors and teachers and accountants and so on. And the argument we develop is that for now and in the medium run, so through the 2020s, these two futures will develop in parallel. You know, we'll see examples of both. But we think that in the longer run, that second future is going to dominate. That through technology, we're going to find new, better ways of solving the sorts of problems that traditionally only very particular types of professionals have solved. And we think this is a really quite significant challenge to the traditional professions. But again, even in the second future, it's not a story of mass unemployment. It's a story of what we say mass redeployment. You know, a change in the sorts of skills and capabilities that people have to have to solve the sorts of problems that traditionally might have just been done by professionals. And in our work, we identify a whole set of skills and capabilities, what these might look like. Just one of the interesting things is that when you show them to traditional professionals, well, One, many of them don't recognize them as being part of their job description. And secondly, they're quite unlike the sorts of things that we train young professionals to do at the moment. Young
Can you give us
and
an example?
Teachers. One example, well, think about, take the medical setting. Think about a data scientist. That's one of 12 roles that we think is important. You know, there is now a system that was developed by a team of researchers at Stanford that can tell you whether or not a freckle is cancerous as accurately as a leading dermatologist. You know, this is a system that is performing the sort of task that might have been done by a doctor, but it's doing it in a very different way. And what's so fascinating about that is that on the paper, which was published in the science journal Nature, the final co-author on that paper was Sebastian Thrun, who's the man who, of course, invented the first driverless car. And this is the spirit of that observation, that the sorts of skills and capabilities and the sorts of people who are best placed to bring those skills and capabilities to bear often aren't traditional professionals. And so we think this is a challenge to traditional professionals who tend to be trained to be the sorts of professionals that dominated the professional world 10, 20 years ago, rather than the sorts of people who will be valuable in 10 or 20 years' time.
I mean, what you're describing is very much how will technology change what we do and who will do it in a way, right? Is it your data scientist? Is it the computer? Is it the radiologist? I mean, there's also that big question of how will technology change how we do our jobs, right? And that brings us back to the discussion, Guy, and Alain, you just had on freelancing, on the gig economy, which is probably just the most visible example of how jobs change and how... So then always one first question that you get invariably from people is, but is this something very small, or will that take over our labor market in 15 years, right? So when we went out to our 11,000 workers, we also asked them, who of you is a gig worker? And to make very sure they really, really knew what we were talking about, we always took the biggest 20 platforms that people could work on in their countries. And we said, these are examples from your country. Have you ever worked on them? And interestingly, we saw that the numbers were very much in line with what you probably also saw in your report. In developed economies, it's always between 1% and 4% of the workforce who derive a primary income from gig platforms. The interesting thing was we also asked people, have you ever worked on such a platform to supplement your primary job? And suddenly that number went up to 35% in China and 25% in India. So very high numbers in markets that have a very big informal work sector. I think that point is a very relevant one. But also 15 additional percent in the US, right? 12 in the UK and Germany. So obviously this is something that might not be 80% of our workforce, but that's big enough to notice. And we really wanted to understand how work changes and how people feel about that work in an area that is so visibly impacted by technology. So I'm very happy to come back to that dominant image we all have in mind of the Uber driver.
Yeah.
But starting with the people you research on, does the gig economy exist there? Does it play a role?
So you do see forms of it. We don't call it the gig economy, but we call it the networked experts model, but it's precisely the same, which are networks of often traditional professionals coming together to work in a far more flexible, far more ad hoc way on particular projects. And so the legal profession's an interesting example of this. You see lawyers on demand at BLP and Peerpoint at Allen and Overy. These are online platforms where lawyers, high-skilled workers, make their skills, capabilities available in a far more flexible, far more ad hoc way. And you see it in lots of different professions. So it's not an exclusively, it's not a story that you only see in more low paid parts of the economy. But I want to come back to what you said, because it's something we've spoken about in the past, which is that many people, when they think about this part of the economy, have an image of Deliveroo and Uber and other platforms like that and associate it often with, rightly or wrongly, you know, unpleasant working conditions.
Yeah, basically Victorian era, you know, exploitation.
Precisely, yeah. And you have looked more closely at this and you found a more nuanced picture. Is that right?
I think we could probably spend another hour on the gig economy alone, and Bindi, I believe, will not give us that. But very briefly, when we asked those of our 11,000 workers who have worked on gig platforms, what they're doing, why they're doing it, and specifically what they would like to do in the future, you see some findings that we didn't expect. One is, on average, this group was happier than the majority of people we talked to. They were more optimistic about their job situation. We also asked them, although, by the way, they worked longer hours. We asked them, let's give you a magic wand. What would be your ideal employment situation in the future? Only a minority wanted to go back to a full-time salaried position, and it was a globally consistent picture with one single example, and that was India. So roughly 20% said, no, I would like to go back to my full-time salaried employment. 50 to 60% in countries actually said, no, I would like more customers through the platform. I'd like to improve my cash flow situation, but I wouldn't want to give up my basic work arrangement on how I work. And what you really see is that people appreciate these elements of the flexibility that was mentioned often today, the choice they have, the self-directed nature of their work. And also in the question of, is it only the Uber driver? No, it isn't. So even in that segment of the workforce that we designed, that I described to you, that should really represent the not the very highly skilled, over half of those gig jobs were actually in reasonably high skill job, so not the driving, transportation, but actually in a range that range from manufacturing to IT to finance and to a lot of services. And I think it's just one examples where one of the examples where you see, yes, I think the reality is a lot more nuanced. There might still be a lot of need for regulation to make sure the risk is evenly distributed, but where I think the question how we work and why people want to work that way and is there a positive that we can keep is really important. We also talk to a lot of employers who increasingly see that as a source of talent that they can't access on the labor market. So I think there's also that flip side of the coin that's a very beneficial one.
Yeah. And so what can what can companies, employers and their employees do to prepare, you know, alongside that research, what emerging best practices are there that you came across?
Look, I think what we saw in general was, yes, workers are very willing to play their part, but they struggle a lot with the how.
Yeah.
And when we asked them, what is the obstacle to you preparing for that unknown future, we got a whole array of answers from, this might be too costly, I might not have the time, this might be a very big financial burden, I don't know if my employer will appreciate me doing this. And I think what you really saw there, people ask for help there, and they look towards their employers, and those don't necessarily have all the answers. Because when we talk to a lot of the CEOs and CHROs, they basically said, look, of course we're talking about the learning organization. We've started launching a number of big top-down reskilling programs, and they are the right answer for a number of problems. If I need to retrain 11,000 hardware engineers and software engineers, that might be the right answer. But they struggled a lot with the small problems. The retail, the shop floor assistants who now need to work alongside fashion bloggers, and how do they do it? And the question of what is that portfolio of experiments, how do we get to more bottom-up formats and how can people learn? How is it less about only formal training, but teams self-selecting and saying, we need to learn something and we need to learn it quickly? That was one of the big challenges companies expressed, but that they're experimenting with. And in terms of good practice, we see that companies, for example, put up these platforms where you can self-nominate with your team saying, this is what we have to learn. And where you're matched not only in the sense of a formal training, but also a staffing opportunity on another project in another part of the company, or even with a supplier or a strategic partner of that company, which I think is a very important piece that companies will not be able to solve that in isolation. obviously this all costs a lot of money, so there's always the question of the investment. And I think there's the question to you on the business case of this.
Yeah.
You know, you invest that all that money in an employee and they're gone to the next job.
Yeah.
Or what's also the risk of not doing it?
Yeah. I mean, it's a difficult question. I mean, it seems to me that the main business case is one of necessity, in the sense that there are two sets of skills that are becoming more important, very crudely, either skills that allow you to compete with machines to do the sorts of things that these systems and machines cannot do, and we can maybe talk more about what those are, or the sets of skills that allow you to build machines, to do the sort to design and operate these systems. And they are becoming increasingly important and increasingly valuable and significant. And again, for me, it's the necessity of being able to access those. Most of us. I mean, there's an interesting parallel, I think, with the sort of more traditional kind of make or buy decision that people have when thinking about new technologies. And it's, you know, talking to professional firms, they face a similar dilemma in wondering, you know, do I want to develop this software internally, or do I want to sign a contract with Google DeepMind, or do I want to sign a contract with IBM's Watson and get them to do it and bring it in instead. The risk here, of course, and the thing that makes it even more difficult is that those systems and machines don't leave at the end, but there's the risk that the workers that you've invested so much in do. So I think it's a difficult and ambiguous problem, but the necessity of having the sorts of people who have those skills, I think, just has to force people to experiment and to try and find business models that work to support the ways that people are increasingly demanding that they want to work.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank
you. Okay. So as per the previous session, we're going to go to Q&A, and I'm going to do a little bit of a competition here. This side had way more questions than this side, so I want to see you guys step up because, you know, they're ahead of the game right now. Okay, gentleman in the white shirt, who are you? Who do you work with, and what do you do with them? And the microphone's on its way.
Thank you. I'm Tony Wilson. I'm the director of the Institute for Employment Studies in the UK. So we do research, consultancy, analysis around employment and HR. Related subjects. That was a really interesting discussion. Thank you for your time. And it sparked a lot of thoughts because we've also done work on the gig economy and about retraining the future of work. And it's one observation, difficult question, I think, around how some of these things interrelate. So the growth in the gig economy and and less formal and the casualization of work combined with a need to reskill and prepare for the future create a tension in themselves. So actually, so what we found is that people who are in temporary employment, for example, and in self-employment, and in more casual forms of work, get less access to training, less access to opportunities, and so are less able to prepare for the future. And as companies, as we rely more on outsourcing, for example, there's less investment in that workforce development, less opportunities for workers to develop new skills and upskill. So it's kind of the question is, you know, what do we do about that proportion of the workforce in the UK, you know, 20% of the workforce who are in self-employment or non-traditional forms of employment are less able to get access to either government-funded or employer-sponsored training. You know, what are the new models that can address that, as well as the new models of sort of social protection and employment regulation? How do we ensure that as work becomes less formal, I suppose, and the role of employers changes, that we can continue to invest in developing our workforce?
And you know, I'll aim to give a couple of examples. I think it's a very, very real challenge, obviously, right? That you know, more people will not be under your direct basically roof. I think there's an even broader problem behind what you were describing, and that is the traditionally narrow notion of talent, because a lot of the learning opportunities in corporations, we're always focused on what we traditionally call the top 100, the top 200, so the top talent, the very highly skilled. And what we do increasingly see is that employers massively broaden that notion simply because they don't get the people they need. You know, I talked to the operator of one of Germany's automotive plants the other day, and their best way to get new people really on the production line was upskill people they had who didn't even speak proper German. And why did they do it? Because there's full employment in the region. They had realized that their best potential was go to those people who they already had, who had worked for the company for 20 years in very unskilled jobs, had no formal qualifications, and finding out that they were missing those formal qualifications because usually they didn't even speak German. And it was the better business case for them to take this group, make sure they learned the language, got some formal training, then go out in the open market and try to source that talent. So I think I'd first advocate for a really broader definition of talent. I think the necessity to which Daniel spoke to source talent will hopefully help to be a lot more flexible in whom do I invest. And the industry that I spent my day job in, the pharmaceutical industry, is actually an industry in that situation where talent is often very scarce. They, for example, do precisely what you described. They will even invest into the training of freelancers and contractors because that's the only way how they can keep these resources and expertise that they need.
I mean, I'll add one observation to that, which is, so before I started thinking about the future of work in an academic setting, I worked in the public policy world. I was in the policy unit in number 10 Downing Street a while ago, and what it strikes me that, and I came to it later in your observation, you first talked about employees, then you talked about employers, and then at the end you talked about government programs. It strikes me that there is a kind of striking lack of innovation from the state, from government, in thinking about how you provide support for people's education throughout their lives. I think there is still in the public policy world a sense that education is the sort of thing that you do at the start of your life. We're happy to pay a lot of money to help people do that. But once that's done, that's it. And you've sort of built up your stock of human capital and you use it throughout your life. And I think that has to change. I think the government needs to, and the public policy in general needs to take a far more broad view of education and supporting it and financing it at different stages throughout life. I mean, the other thing that makes it even more difficult is that the future is very uncertain, and we can talk about the skills and capabilities today that we think might be important, but those might change as well. So helping people deal with that uncertainty every 5-10 years is going to become more important. So for me, a big part of the answer to you would be more innovation from public policy.
We've got a gentleman here on the right. Well done, you guys are catching up. Over here? Over? You do, okay, I'll get to you next. But next, you're the next one. So who are you? And feel free to ask
Hi everyone,
your question.
I'm Vahid. I'm Vahid Kamsi from SAP. I run strategy for Europe. And actually, I was coming from Singapore for the last 8 years, where the gig economy, for my sense, is seen as extremely positive. Because not only it is the technology is replacing, enhancing, but also it's enabling lots of women who get back to work to access new income, to people who actually don't speak the language. Through Uber, we have people that are not native speakers or people who are hard of hearing who wouldn't be able to work as a taxi driver. So my sense is, yes, we talk about gig economy as something that will make it more precarious to be trained, to grow, but also it's a huge enabler for new people to access the market. So what's your thinking around that?
I find it intriguing that you mentioned that because, I talked about the gig economy to a number of union leaders and not to be unkind, those were not the people I expected to be positive about the gig economy for obvious reasons. And while they also shared some very valid concerns, they also said, listen, we need to be very careful to understand this well because we can't just regulate it away. And they came with precisely your points that they said, often for women, for the elderly, for immigrants, for people with disabilities, or also people working in very rural parts of the country, that's often the only means of access to the labor market, and we need to be very careful that we don't cut it. We also saw in our data that as many people told us that they had lost their job due to the freelance and gig economy, then had told us that they had found a job out of unemployment through it.
And I think it just in the professional setting as well, these platforms are often the ones that support flexible working are often viewed positively, or can be viewed positively, for similar reasons to those you're suggesting. People who spend lots of time training to be a particular type of professional then need to take time out the labor market for some reason, perhaps parenting duties, and then want to re-enter the labor market in these platforms offer far more flexible, far more far more flexible way of doing that. So I think there are two sides to this, but what is flexibility for some people is insecurity for others, and I think it's important to see both parts of that story.
Great. Last question. Who are you, and yes. Tell us where you're from.
Yes, hi. My name is Elma. I work with a company called Area 9. We specialize in four-dimensional adaptive learning. And it's just one of the observations that I have. We don't bring up so much new thinking when it comes to education and learning. Most specifically soft skills, because as you correctly mentioned, we don't know what jobs may come, but we actually do know that there is resistance to change. So why don't we utilize more the tools we have so we also train people in being more resilient, in being ready for change, and taking that kind of, utilizing the tools we have today to train people, to train the soft skills that we know are needed and will be needed in future as well.
Mm. In my mind, there's three parts to what we need to do in education. One is change what we teach, which is what you've spoken about and which is what we spoke about as well. Another is, when we teach people, and that was to the point earlier, which is that we need to move away from thinking that it's something you just do at the start of your life. I thought what you were going to say, because of the name of your company, was change how we teach as well. Because some of the most, in my mind, some of the most interesting innovations in the world of education are in adaptive and personalized learning systems. And I don't know if that's what your organization does, but it's one of the robust findings in the world of education is that an average student who has one-to-one tuition will tend to outperform 98% of their, but that's not affordable if that one-to-one tuition is with a human being, and so personalized adaptive learning systems are quite exciting. So I think there are three parts to what we need to do. One, what we teach. Two, how we teach. And then thirdly is the how often we teach, when we teach.
Did you have any comments?
No, I was just starting to make a disparaging comment, saying you're coming very threateningly towards us. So
this is the cue. Our time is almost
better
up.
Better not happen.
So you get the last word, Judith.
No. So I think the my more a reflection. I think the what we shared. I think our is a very positive outlook on what's coming, on the opportunity behind it. And I think a big challenge that we're always hit with when we discuss it is that people tell us, aren't you just completely delusioned? Aren't you talking to people who also don't see what's coming? Are they too blinded by the fact that the economy is doing great at the moment and what's ahead, right? And I think I would still advocate for a very optimistic outlook, precisely with what Guy mentioned. I think it doesn't help to sit back in a doom and gloom, and I think it also takes people out of responsibility, right? And we really need to ask ourselves of how we shape what's coming, because the chance that we succeed in that, I think, is much bigger than sitting back and waiting for the dark cloud to hit.
That's great. That's a really fantastic ending. Thank you to the two of you your wonderful insights.
Thank you.
So how do I summarize those previous two sessions? Wow, some pretty interesting stuff. Sharing with you a couple of the things that I observed, I'm going to take Guy's three points in his paper. Because I found that very interesting. First of all, it's sort of about, this is human-centric. It's not technology leading the human. It's human being ahead of where the technology takes us. And it's how the technology enables us as humans in the next 5 to 10 years. I think the people capabilities was quite interesting. How do we make our employees and people in the gig economy feel safer with change? I really enjoyed the findings from the BCG study, where it was actually quite confident, and people were saying, it's up to me. It would be great if my employer could be part of this, but it really is up to me. So that was quite an interesting insight, because I didn't expect to see that. But coming from London myself, half of what we do is gig economy related. I can't imagine life without Uber or a Deliveroo or a TaskRabbit because London is so busy. I could give you so many more apps like that. The sustainable and decent jobs, I think that's really key. How do we define, and I really enjoyed what Daniel had to say around that, which is the definition of what a professional is changing. You know, that when he talked about doctors and lawyers, and it's lawyers on demand, and all of a sudden radiologists have to not necessarily look at what the results of the x-ray are, but actually diagnose what to do with the results, because the AI has already done that initial diagnosis. So again, very, very fascinating. Institutions of work, this is all of us, correct? And do the institutions of work need to be Uberized? Again, I like what Daniel had to say, the network experts model. That's the very corporate way of saying it, but Uberized is how the geeks say it. You know, and actually, the BCG study was interesting, where let's talk to the workers, let's not talk to the people that are leading the organization, but how are they feeling? And so that was very interesting to me to see the kind of level of confidence that people were feeling. So again, I hope you take some of this stuff from this plenary session and take it to your breakouts, which is a nice segue to what is next. So again, if you haven't downloaded the app, you have your printout, you know what sessions you're going to next. There are snacks actually physically at your sections, so you don't have to dilly-dally, as they say in the United Kingdom. Please go to either the next building or to the two rooms upstairs. Again, and I encourage you, this is not about defining the problem. We know what the problem is. Let's get to some concrete solutions and ideas. By the end of today, let's talk about what some of those ideas are. So with that, off you go.